Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
If you all stand, turn to number 498, and we all get to heaven. 498.
Lord, we thank you for the day we had. We thank you, Lord, for the service we're about to have, Lord, the time to be able to be here. I ask you, Lord, to be with us now. Lord, I ask you to be with the teenagers and the junior campers, Lord, and as they are getting themselves ready with their singing and also getting ready, Lord, to be able to express their time they had at camp, Lord. I pray you be with them, calm their nerves, Lord, comfort them, give them the strength they need. And I also, Lord, ask you to be with preaching tonight, Lord, and be with the preacher, Lord, as he preaches. Give them the words to say and speak through them this evening. Be with our services tonight. In Jesus' name, amen.
Jesus, my Lord, wonderful. Eyes have seen.
We'll all stand one more time. Turn to number 279, Child of the King. 279, Child of the King.
My Father is rich.
$7 to get into the fair and any food or drinks that you want. The Wednesday night at Cedar Point trip will be July 31st, which is kind of hype. The senior trip to the Sight and Sound Theater is September 18th and 19th. The cost is $200 per room. There's two tickets, and please pay by July 30th so the rooms and tickets can be reserved. You will also need to take money for two dinners and breakfast. There is a sign-up sheet in the vestibule. The pastor will be on vacation from August 5th through 14th. If you have an emergency, please call the assistant pastor, Dan Santucci, or any of the deacons. Update on Roger. Trying to get sugar and blood pressure down. MRI scheduled tomorrow. Prayers for him. And prayers for Wade Lester, who's in rehab in Princeton.
Let's
all stand and shake hands.
Thank you.
really enjoyed going there. It was very nice. The food, very, very good. The messages, outstanding. And I made decisions there. The Lord spoke to me, and I wanted to give my life and do exactly what He wanted me to do for my life. So I dedicated my life to Him. And then I won best on the team for junior camp. So this is the only badge I got. So I'm happy.
To both camps this year. It was really fun. At team camp, there was a lot of great messages, but there was one message that really spoke to my heart, and it was about, I lost my whole train of thought. It was about surrendering your life to the ministry, and I was just getting really convicted about that. So that night, I went back, and I did God's Will in My Life, and I started to be a preacher. And then at junior camp, there was also a lot of great messages and a lot of good food and fun games. And it was just really fun and awesome. So I'm very happy about that.
This was my third year at camp as well. And there was two messages that really, really spoke to my heart, and it was about staying in your Bible more and praying more. I made a lot of new friends and had a really good time, and unlike them, I had three awards. I had a second place award, I got best boy on my team, and I was one out of the two people in the whole camp who did the verse test.
So I had the privilege of going to both weeks of camp this year, and one was to be a counselor and one was to be a camper, and I'm going to talk about being counselor first. I just want to say that I had an amazing time being a counselor, and it was such an amazing experience to see the kids grow in the Lord, and it was such an amazing experience for me to see everything that went on through the kids' lives, and I got the privilege to also lead a kid to the Lord, and she was so amazing, and she wanted to ask so many questions, and that was another thing about the kids. They wanted to know so much, and they asked so many questions, and to see them want to learn their kids, them encourage each other, it was just amazing, and I had a great time at junior camp. And at teen camp, probably my favorite thing is seeing all the relationships that were built and that have been being built. And I've been to teen camp 3 years now, and they have just been getting stronger. And I feel like for some camps, it's just you don't really stay like in touch with your friends at camp. You sort of just lose touch with them. But at this camp, you can really tell the relationships that are built are for a lifetime. And I've made so many friendships there that I will forever cherish, and I thank God for it. And I'm so thankful that God surrounded me with so many godly people and influences throughout the week. And that's why I like that stuff.
Like Rachel, I also have the privilege of going to both camps this year, counseling in junior camp and being a teen camper. Junior camp, if you've never counseled a camp before, it's something that you really can't forget. It's fun, it really is, but kids can exhaust you. It's fourth grade through seventh grade, which in my opinion is the worst age. I was never that old. But I got back and Pastor Walter actually asked me, he said, well, how many kids do you want to have now? And I'm like, but it really is amazing, and as much as we talk about, as bad as it is or how tiring it is, it really is worth it all when you see the growth and what happens to those kids. We saw at junior camp, it was 10 or 11 kids accepting Christ as their Savior. Mm-hmm. And on Thursday night alone, the last night of camp, we had 8 kids come out and commit to them, to either the mission field or to ministry in general. And it really was amazing. And I had the privilege of dealing with some of those kids. And it really is something to never forget. So definitely try it if you never have. Teen camp was really fun. Yeah. And I'd like to speak on what Rachel said is with the friendships. And you do go a lot of places and you don't remember these people and you're going to forget those people. And that's what they tell you, is they tell you, you know, you get out of high school, you're not going to remember any of your friends. These are friends that myself and Rachel, at least, have gone up, had made her parents drive 2.5 hours to go see them, right? These are some of our best friends. And it's something you'll never forget. And the most important part about it is they're good, godly friends who are going to encourage you the whole way. Yeah. And as long as you have those in your life, as long as you keep good, godly friends, you keep the word, you keep praying, and you keep God in your life, I promise you, He will bless you. That's all I have to say.
One of my favorite things about camp is the atmosphere. It's just everyone just wants to learn about God and just get to know Him better. As Rachel and Andrew talked about, the friendships we have there, like some of my best friends are from there. And one night I can remember, it was just everyone at the altar just holding each other and just hugging each other. And it really touched my heart because it's good godly friends, as they say. I really liked the food and games. The food was really good. One of my favorite parts was seeing Jordan there. If you don't know, Jordan's one of the best kids you'll ever meet. But then again, seeing Riley make peanut butter and jelly with her feet and give it to one of our team members too, that was pretty good too.
This is my third week of teen camp, and it was a lot of fun, and the food was very good. I really like the tacos. They were delicious. But the games were really fun too, but the messages were very good. And one message really spoke to me. It was Friday night's message. It was about doing decisions that would count for eternity and to not waste your life away. And that one really spoke to me. So.
This is my second year ever going to camp at all. And this is probably my favorite year so far. We got to stay at the Greenbrier Christian Retreat, and it was a lot nicer than the island. It was huge. There was a lot more things to do. But all through the week, every single night, there was great messages. And I think the one that spoke to me the most was letting go of bitterness. We all have bitterness in our lives that we're holding on to. And I just decided that I need to be more forgiving and let go of a lot of that. As for my actual team, we were awful. We were not athletic. We came in fourth, and we were in fourth every night. But it was good. There was a very friendly atmosphere on our team. We were all super close. We all got along really well. And even though we weren't doing good, we were still there for each other, and that was really nice. So that's what I love about camp, is we can all be there for each other. We can all praise God together, and yeah, that's just nice.
So I was on Lexi's team. We got last. I think I've gotten last, either second or fourth, the last. I think every teen camp I went to, it's pretty tragic, but the thing I like there is the food. The food is pretty good, but I gotta say, it doesn't compete with Cold War food. Like, stands no chance. Cold War food is the best. I didn't make any, decisions at camp this year, but just being there, like they mentioned, the atmosphere around it, everything, just seeing people go forward, people going backwards, making decisions, it's just, I find that amazing, and that's really good.
Well, this was my second year at teen camp, and it was by far my favorite year at camp. It was lots of fun. The atmosphere, like they said, was everybody was just fun to be around. Everybody got along. But there was one message on Tuesday morning. Pastor Tommy was talking about how God used the disciples and took them and used them throughout the world, and they worked through him. And it just, he made the comment that God took 12 sinners just like all of us, and how he used them, and he could just take us and do the same thing with us if we're willing to let him.
Sure.
That was all I got to say. They might remember, but probably not remember the games they won, or if their team won at camp or not. But in 20 years, they're going to remember the spiritual decisions and the friends they made and the people they led to the Lord at church camp. And it's very important, very much needed in today's society. And tonight, I just wanted to go over a few verses. I'm going to pull a Pastor Walt. I got a short message, and I'm going to go for 45 minutes. I'm just teasing. The way the Lord puts things together, and Pastor Walt has mentioned this several times, the way the Lord puts things together sometimes is, his timing is definitely not our timing.
Right.
I can tell you that right now. I was at work. I worked all weekend, worked today. I got a text from Pastor Walt yesterday. He said, "Hey, you guys doing the team service tomorrow?" I haven't even been to church. I haven't talked to him. Beth and I haven't talked to him. But the Lord was working, and Beth got with the kids this morning, and we wanted to do it right after camp was done. So, because if you wait a few weeks or a month, It's not the same. They're not as excited about it as they are right now when they just come back from camp, and it doesn't carry the message like it does right after camp is over. They're still remembering and excited about the things that went on. So we wanted to get the team service, the camp service in, and then we started realizing, wait a minute, we're going to be gone next week. He's going to be gone weeks after that. I said, if we don't do it tonight, then we're not going to get it in. So the Lord wanted it tonight. And so we've been throwing everything together. And the Lord, I was up this morning going to work, listening to the Bible, trying to study on my breaks and stuff today at work and put together a message. And as I got in my car and started home, I love to listen to sermon audio a lot. And I said, you know, I'm just going to listen to a message on the way home, just try to get my mind focused, get thinking about things. And I listened to a message from Scott Pauley, and it was kind of along the lines of what God had laid on my heart already, but it said it so much better than I had tried to put together. And I said, thank you, Lord. You know, I mean, I literally come in and wrote the things down that I had just finished listening to in the parking lot when I pulled in because I was finishing up that message, listening to Brother Scott Pauley. And it's like the Lord just put everything together. And I just want to bring a message tonight in the book of Titus. Turn with me to the book of Titus. Book of Titus, chapter 2. Titus chapter 2, we'll begin reading in verse 1. But speak thou the things which become sound doctrine, that the aged men be sober, grave, temperate, sound in faith, in charity, and in patience. The aged women likewise, that they be in behavior as becometh holiness, not false accusers, not given much wine, teachers of good things, that they may teach the young women to be sober, to love their husbands, to love their children, to be discreet, chaste, keepers at home, good, obedient to their own husbands, that the word of God be not blasphemed. Young men likewise exhort to be sober-minded, in all things showing thyself a pattern of good works, in doctrine showing uncorruptness, gravity, sincerity, sound speech that cannot be condemned, that he that it is of contrary part may be ashamed, having no evil thing to say of you. Let's bow with a word of prayer. Dear Lord, I thank you for the day you've given us, Lord. I thank you for bringing us all together tonight. Thank you for Sunday night service. Thank you for the teams doing the service. Thank you for how things have gone. And just thank you, God, for us in our church. Thank you for allowing us to be able to send them to a camp that's grounded in your word and teaches them the truths of your word, Lord, and challenges them to do and to make spiritual decisions. I just pray, God, that you bless the service tonight. Just get me out of the way, Lord. Pray, God, that the message will be the message you want delivered. And just be with us and watch over and protect us as we travel. Let's pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay. So here in Titus chapter 2, we just read the first 8 verses. First of all, there are some references in these verses about the aged men and the aged women teaching the younger men and the younger women. And, I mean, it should be just common sense, but guys, that's how it's supposed to be. Our kids should not be getting their... Our kids shouldn't be getting their help, and they shouldn't be getting their help from their friends at school. Their, you know, friends and stuff help sometimes, and they can give us advice. But when it comes to life decisions, look at, was it Rehoboam or Jeroboam? I get those two confused. Rehoboam had the option of listening to the older men in Israel and being easier on the Israelites and not being as hard as his father was. Or the people that was his age gave him the advice to, you know, be really hard on him and say, you know, I'm going to be harder on him than my father was. And he listened to his friends. He listened to the people of his generation. And it split the kingdom. And in our church, in today's society, our kids are crying out for some advice, for some help. They are. And they're reaching out to whoever and whatever will give them something. They're so starved for just that companionship that they're willing to get it from anyone. And unfortunately, it's our generation. My son calls them the sweaty tryhards. Some of them call me a boomer. I don't know how many times he's looked at me and said, okay, boomer. But it's our generation that's put our nose to the grindstone and put in 60, 80, 100 hours a week at work and have left social media, music, and friends at school to raise our children. And we got to get that back, guys.
Right.
You younger couples is in here. Middle-aged couples is in here. Older couples is in here. You have a tie to
some young people somewhere, whether it be your kids, whether it be your grandkids, whether it be kids that you will be having soon, some of you younger married couples. God be blessing you with children soon, good Lord willing. You got to take this nap and go with it. Let's look at how to have a healthy church. If you're alive, raise your hand. All right, there's 10 of you. The person beside you did not raise your hand. You might want to reach over and check on them. But we all might be alive, but are we healthy? How many of you guys are saved in here? Yeah. Look all around. Praise the Lord. I got a home in heaven. Just because I'm a Christian and I'm saved don't mean I'm spiritually healthy.
Right.
There's three things that Paul writes to Titus here that stands out in this chapter. How to have a healthy church. First of all, let's look in verse 1. But speak thou the things which become sound doctrine. Sound doctrine, or healthy teaching. That word sound in the Bible is a very interesting word. It's stable. Having a sound foundation. Something that stands firm, stands strong. That's something that's sound. And that's what Paul is telling Titus here. Have a sound doctrine. We as adults, we as parents, grandparents, uncles, aunts, it is not the pastor's job to have his doctrine sound. It is, personally, for him. But it's not his job to have it for all of us. It's up to us as Christians to know what we believe and why we believe it, and be able to give an answer for why we believe it. That's having sound doctrine. We got to have a healthy teaching. And if I've learned one thing in the 26 years of dealing with teenagers, it's they have x-ray vision. They do. They do. You don't get nothing as a teenager. They can see right through you whether you're sincere, whether you mean what you say, whether you are what you act to be. They do. They look right through you. They can tell if you're practicing what you're preaching or not. Now, I had a house full of boys. And I got one left now. He's itching to get out. But I'm telling you, parents, kids, see right through you. Just the way it is. You can't practice do as I say and not as I do.
Right, yes.
That doesn't work.
Right.
It doesn't work. Especially when it comes to children, teenagers, young people. Well, they see that right off the bat. The second thing we see here in Titus about having a healthy church. Let's look. Like I said, I was writing this down as I come in. I've got it written down, but I didn't write that. Let's look back in verse 13 of chapter 1. Chapter 1, verse 13, back up there a few verses. This witness is true, wherefore rebuke them sharply, that they may be sound in the faith. We must have a sound faith. This is healthy living. You know, it's one thing to have your teaching right, you know, to study God's word, to know what's right and wrong, to understand what God expects from us. But it's another thing to practice that. That's the healthy living. The Bible says the just shall go to heaven by faith. The Bible says the just shall live by faith. James tells us that faith without is dead. There's not very many dead people that are healthy. If you're going to have a healthy life in Christ, if we're going to have a healthy church, We've got to have healthy living. We've got to take the truths that God has given us and practice them in our own personal life. And when we do that, these guys see it. Then you know what? Have you ever seen... I used to love to watch the Olympics. And one of my favorite things to watch was the relay race. I did. The way those runners was just... It was like they was in a... It was a machine. It was just... Their steps were perfectly timed. They went around that track as fast as could be. But the hardest part about a relay race is you don't do it yourself. There's another person up in front of you right here that as you're running, they've got to take off too, and they got to look back. And in stride, they got to reach back, take that baton, and keep striding. And you can tell a team that is well-versed in handing off the baton and a team that's not. I don't know how many times, especially in high school, when we go to a track meet, you watch that relay race and they drop that baton. Then you laugh. Oh, yeah. But you know what? In today's churches, guys, we're dropping the baton.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
We're dropping the baton. These guys are striding along, trying to pick it up. But are we handing it to them? Are we right behind them? Are we there with them step for step, handing them what they need? Well, that's what we got to do as adults, as the elders in our church, as the aged men. We've got to hand that baton to the young guys. That's what these kind of services is all about. We've got to teach these kids how to serve the Lord. Because in 20 years, I want there to still be somebody standing here preaching to a congregation full of people.
That's right.
That's what it's all about. Until the Lord comes, I want somebody here telling the congregation about Jesus. That's what it's all about. Thirdly, so we've got sound doctrine, healthy teaching, sound faith, healthy living. And let's go back to chapter 2, down in verse 8. The very first phrase in verse 8, sound speech. That's healthy speaking. Like I said, you can't practice do as I say, not as I do. If you're healthy, if your teaching's not right and your living's not right, your speech ain't going to be right. Every time I think about this, my mind goes back to the story of Sodom and Gomorrah and Lot getting out with his family. And there's a verse in there that has always pricked my heart. And I know I'm far from being a perfect dad. Far from it. I'm just dad. You know, I'm flesh and blood. I try to do what's right, but I'm far from being a perfect dad. But as I read about Sodom and Gomorrah and Lot trying to get his family to leave, there's a phrase in there that when Lot come in and talk to his daughters and their husbands, the Bible says, to them he seemed as one that mocked.
Yeah.
When you get serious about talking to your kids about the Lord, when you get serious about trying to give them something to hold on to for the rest of their life, do your kids think, what's he talking about? You know? What are they trying to do? Or do they listen? Do their ears perk up and listen because they've seen how you live your life? They've seen what you've been trying to teach them and they're going to listen to you? Or are they just going to go, I don't know what he's talking about. I've seen what he does. I've heard the way he talks to mom. I've heard the way his buddies at work come around and talk about how he acts at work. What's he going to tell me how to live? Unfortunately, that's the way a lot of our kids see us as parents.
Right.
they see the parent that's in the home, but when they get a little years on them, they get them teenage years, that's why a lot of them become rebellious, because they get out and they find out in the community who mom and dad is.
Yeah.
And that's unfortunate. As a young man, and it had a lot to do with that verse I just told you about, God pricked my heart a long, long time ago about that. And as a young man, when I start working in factory work, I pray, Lord, I pray that I'll be the same guy at work that I am at home.
Yeah.
And adults, there's no greater gift, men, that we can give our wives and we can give our children is if we're just faithful at home, at work, yeah, and at church.
Yeah.
If you're the same guy that comes in the house after a long day at work, that you are when you walk in the doors back here at the church, that's a gift that you give your family for years to come.
Yeah.
It's just being true and being faithful. And that's what it takes. We don't have to pull off some miracle as a parent or as an elder in the church trying to teach these younger people. These young people aren't looking for somebody to do some great work in their life and pull off some miracle. They're just looking for somebody to stand right with them. They're just looking for somebody to walk with them and guide them. And you know what? I was talking to somebody at work today, and every time somebody talks to me at work about my church and stuff, about going to church, I wear a lot of my Cold War shirts to work. And they're like, you got to do that Cold War thing. I said, yeah, we do. And it's like, you got to do a lot with kids? I said, as much as we can. As much as we can. We work with teenagers. We work with young people. And they say, but the girl I was talking to today is like, you know, there's not a lot of churches around that have good teen groups and good youth activities and stuff. It's just not around anymore. I said, I know. I said, and it's unfortunate. I said, there's two reasons for that. I said, number one, it's expensive. A lot of churches don't want to put the finances into funding stuff for the young people. Number two, it takes work. This doesn't happen, and I'm not tooting our own horn here, because God has done a wonderful thing in our church. But it happens through people's work.
Yes.
Coming together, having a vision. The book of Proverbs says, where there's no vision, the people perish. We as a church, as adults, have a vision for this church to stay here. The good Lord allowed this church to be built right here in 1900. It's been here 123 years. And bless the Lord, if I've got anything to do with it, I want to be here for 123 more years until Jesus comes.
Amen.
That's our job. That's our job here in the local church. Our job is to keep pressing on during our time that God's put us here and hand it off to them so they'll press on during their time. Well, and that's how it's done. That's how it's reproduced. A healthy plant reproduces after its kind. And if we want to be a healthy church, we need to reproduce after our kind. It's got to keep going. It's got to keep going. And I'm not saying anything tonight that you guys don't already know. I'm not saying anything new. But that's kind of the point. We just got to keep treading on. We just got to keep faithful. We've got to stay with it as adults, as parents, as teachers, that sound doctrine, and that's one thing that God has blessed this church so much with. Because I know as in Pastor Walt's mind, it's a blessing. And in my mind, as the youth director in the teen group, it's a blessing. But I know that from the nursery all the way through teen group, these kids are getting taught the same thing.
Yeah.
And that is a blessing, that God's word is being taught the same every step of the way. And if God has given you a position to teach these kids as they come up, whatever class it may be, however it is, you know, whatever class you have, take it seriously and stay with God's word. Because that's how we get these kids grounded and going in the right direction. All right. Time for our invitation. You ready for that, Andrew? I love these teenagers, though. All right. Let's all stand. Let's have an invitation.
$125. Jesus paid it all.
Help us be soul winners for you and good examples for you, Lord, among those around us. Lord, you help us to live as Christians, Lord, and live as we believe, I pray. I do just pray for this night. I pray that you keep everybody safe on their way home. And just thank you so much for all you do for us, Lord, and all you've given to us. I also pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
God bless you.